made a CD, which came out on ECM Records, the ECM label. It was done, it's really a life's dream of mine to record with a large string ensemble. Here there were 13 strings in all, and myself, and Carlos Francetti, who is the conductor. And he also did the orchestrations, and we worked together on the arrangements, but basically he orchestrated all the music for the strings. Having something like this happening for me, it's, as I said, it took many, many years for it to come about, and was finally afforded the opportunity to do it, and contacted Carlos, who had been recommended to me by many people as somebody who really knows how to write for strings. So when I spoke with him initially about the project, he apparently had been a fan of mine for some years, and he knew music I had written 30 years ago and some lyrics that I had written along with some of the music, and so, and he was able to sing them back to me, which sort of blew me away, the fact that he was really knew about my history, and it's very flattering, and at the same time we sort of hit it off right away, and then we collaborated and we met a number of times prior to the recording, to the session itself, and worked together on the arrangements. But as I said, he orchestrated everything for the strings and he conducted at the session. I did the CD. It's really a dedication, a homage to my parents, who were both Hungarian immigrants. They came over to this country at a very early age, and their parents as well, everybody, both the grandparents and my parents are from Budapest, Hungary. And in order to get away from the government and the oppression that was existing over there, they came over here, all of them did, and sort of enabled me to do, to live in a free society where I could do ultimately whatever I chose to do. And so they, when I was very young, they gave me music lessons and things like that. And so unfortunately, none of them are around anymore, but this is my dedication and my thanks in a way to letting, for them allowing me to be able to express myself and to be able to do this music, which I wouldn't have been able to do if I had lived in another country, let's say in Hungary, for example. I was born in Brooklyn many years ago, in the Sheepshead Bay section of Brooklyn, Avenue X and 17th Street, and we lived in a attached bungalow. It was a row houses, and they were all attached, but it was a relatively nice, quiet neighborhood, and it's still there. I recently went back there, and it looks pretty much the same, except there are now bars up on some of the windows, which is, I guess, a sign of the times. Back in the late 30s, early 40s, that didn't exist, of course. And I lived in Brooklyn for 9 years until we moved to Chicago in 1947. My father's business took us all there. And we stayed in Chicago for 3 years and then moved to Boston, where I essentially grew up in my formative years in terms of schools and studying. I went to high school and college in Boston and was able to study with a woman by the name of Margaret Shaloff, who essentially had to undo a lot of the piano, the technique that I had learned. I started studying when I was 5 in Brooklyn, but for 7 years I had studied prior to meeting her in Boston when I was 12, and then technically speaking she sort of undid everything I had learned, because it wasn't really that, it needed some polishing. So basically she re-educated me in terms of how to play the piano and what they call the Russian school of piano technique, which is kind of involved. But it basically, it's mostly about getting a sound on the instrument, a piano sound. And it has to do with how you hold your arms and hands and think about how the sound travels. It can, if you really want a very loud sound, you think of the sound traveling from your feet, and it comes up through your legs, through your torso, and out through your arms to your fingertip. And the principle is the same as if you're blowing into an instrument. The sound comes out your fingertips and you're blowing into the key, and it's breathing from the diaphragm. So any instrumentalist, whether you're a pianist, a horn player, a drummer, a bass player, it doesn't matter. It's the principle of the breathing And if you allow that sound to come through unobstructed, in other words, you don't tighten up your arms, you don't tense anywhere, the sound will come out and then come out the piano and the soundboard and just flow naturally. And that's about getting the sound that the piano should get. A lot of pianists are not really aware of that, and they may tense up in their arms, and therefore they block the flow of the sound. And it sounds, the sound is brittle. It's not really a good piano sound. But the Russian school of piano technique, which is about this, has to do with this kind of getting the sound. All the great classical Russian composers, Richter and Horowitz and Gieseking, you can up and down the line, get this sound, are able to get this sound because they understand the principle of it. And also, aside from the sound, you can, if you really get it in your head, you're able to play in any speed that you want, fast, slow, and also dynamically from the softest sound to the triple sforzando, let's say. Well, the Russian technique just is part of getting your tools, getting your craft together, along with knowing harmony, and it's just about over the years assimilating all these things, the technical tools and the harmonic tools, and just being absorbed a lot of the repertoire and the history of the music until you really don't have to think about it and you really can begin to play what's in your heart, which is, I mean, what the most important thing is, to be an individual and to play what you really feel and to have that come out individually without having influences, and overtly obvious. Now, everybody has influences. I certainly had my share, as everyone else did. But I think if ultimately you can assimilate all the tools that you learn from the technique and studying harmony and listening to the music, going out working, which I started to do when I was 13 years old as a professional, and just in all kinds of musical settings, Latin bands, commercial jobs, just you name it and I've done it. All that will contribute to really what you bring to the music and state individually, which is what I've tried to do all these years. The rehearsals, for me, we rehearsed with the string music, of course, because there are 13 strings involved and there's music to be read. When I work with my trio, no, we've never rehearsed, but there's a commonality in terms of the history and knowing the language and knowing the people I'm working with who are extremely talented. And to me, rehearsals are not really necessary, but we can talk about how we're going to approach a piece. And we can do that prior to a job, or do the piece on the job, and it's going to change from time to time anyway. As each time we play it, it'll be different. So I don't really believe that much in rehearsals. The people I work with respond to that, and it's very nice. I think rehearsing can be, it's needed at times, certainly, and I don't say you should never rehearse, but for the trio, and my trio, we've never rehearsed. My influences growing up were, wow, I could start with Louis Armstrong, Fats Waller, Art Tatum, certainly the greatest, for me, the greatest pianist who ever lived in terms of his technical ability, as well as his harmonic sophistication and his swing. He had every all the elements together. He was absolutely astounding. And from Art Tatum, there's Errol Garner, Bud Powell. I'm sure I'm leaving out people, but and Charlie Parker was an enormous influence. John Coltrane, of course, was. Any number of people, as well as a lot of classical composers that I studied and played when I was very young, especially the French Impressionists, Ravel and Debussy and Fauré, and early 20th century classical music, Schoenberg and Webern, Bartok. But the idea for me was to, at some point, you assimilate all these influences and really try to play yourself, and it's been a process, and it's an ongoing process. I think over the last 20 years, probably, my voice has become more distinct, and it keeps getting that way, but it's a work in progress. It's always a work in progress. When I came to New York after finishing, I graduated from Harvard in 1959, and went to, it was called Lenox School of Jazz. It was a 3-week course in Lenox, Massachusetts, where I received a scholarship and was able to study or hang out with, that's what it turned out to be. The Modern Jazz Quartet was up there at that time. Kenny Dorham was there, Gunther Schuller, George Russell, Bill Evans, and the students, aside from myself, Ornette Coleman was a student at that year, Don Cherry, Gary McFarland. So it was really just a wonderful 3-week period where we spent time with these, our so-called teachers, but yet it turned out to be just more of a social event, and learned a lot, but I was also able to meet a lot of these people. And when I came to New York in the fall of that year, which was just a month or so later, and I called everybody saying I was in New York, if anybody knew, needed a piano player, here I am, and Kenny Dorham, it turns out, needed a pianist. So I joined his quintet in the fall of 1959, and we worked in a club in Bed-Stuy called Turbo Village, I remember, a funky little club. But it was great. I mean, it was an upright piano. It was not the greatest instrument in the world. It was a quintet with Kenny and Charles Davis, who was a baritone saxophone player and rhythm section. And that lasted until I had heard Coltrane had left Miles and was looking to form a band, a quartet. And basically, this is not my usual way of going about things, because I'm kind of shy, but I called him. I've got his number and called him, and I introduced myself and said, I know you don't know who I am, but I would love if we could get together, maybe talk about the music. I know you're trying to put a quartet together. And he agreed to do that, and we met a couple of times, and long story short, he hired me. Then, you know, a few weeks after our first meeting, and we worked at a place called the Jazz Gallery on St. Mark's Place,